大行的得名啊，是。但是我忙起来上了，这具体是啥子啊？
So the next outline is identifying the afflictions, and broadly, 10 types of afflictions are identified. 5 which belongs to the category of view, and 5 which are non-view afflictions. But actually, experientially speaking, when it comes to afflictions, this is a category of phenomena which we are all very familiar with.
Hmm. If we analyze carefully in our experience, then it's quite clear, if we pay attention, then I think it's quite clear. Most disturbances of the mind is those negative emotions. We call nyumo. Lokang jena, rang jun de jikangsa.
So these kaleshas or nyonmong in Tibetan, afflictions which as Asanga defined, these are mental states whose arising... These are mental states arising... These are mental states arising on which create a disturbance within the mental continuum of the individual. So these are the afflictions or nyomon.
The digic yamnaga is a tawang of the temingas. Teming yomon said, Karalok or Rengsing that Rengsis already.
So one important point to understand from the basic distinction that is drawn between those afflictions which belong to the class of views and those afflictions which are classified as non-view, I think there is an important point that needs to be understood here. For example, if you look at afflictions such as attachment, aversion, and so on, which belong to the category of non-view class, there, the primary kind of modality of the emotions themselves are less cognitive, and they are more affective states. Therefore, the element of cognitive ascertainment is lesser. Compared to them, the view, those afflictions which belong to the category of view, and they are in fact and described as distorted forms of intelligence or afflicted intelligence, sharab nyomong jen. And so these, in a sense, are more serious forms of afflictions. And because of their you know, kind of distorted nature as some form of distorted intelligence, they also tend to have a greater kind of, you know, a sense of cognitive orientation and also ascertainment, false ascertainment as well. And similarly, when you apply antidote to these different emotions, for the non-view type emotions like attachment or aversion, then there are specific antidotes that are presented in the teachings. For example, as an antidote to aversion or anger or hatred, a cultivation of loving kindness is recommended as an antidote to dealing with attachment and particularly lust. Meditation on the impurity of the body and so on is recommended. However, these forms of antidotes are really understood more as a kind of antidotes that act more in the form of suppression rather than total eradication. Whereas if you look at the view type afflictions, which are afflicted forms of intelligence, given that there are forms of intelligence, their antidotes must also take similar form of application of intelligence. So the principal antidotes here are more of a wisdom type practices, and so these are also antidotes which are eliminating antidotes, eradicating antidotes. In Prasanapada, Chandrakirti, when commenting on the different functions of the antidotes of specific afflictions, although he may be speaking in the context of subtle understanding of afflictions according to the Madhyamaka Prasangika system, but he makes the following point. He says that the antidotes against the individual afflictions such as attachment and aversion or anger that are presented in the sutras, if you analyze them, if you examine them carefully, then these antidotes are very specific to their corresponding afflictions. And one, for example, like the antidote against attachment, which is the meditation on impurity of the human body, and the antidote against lust, that antidote will work only against lust and that type of emotions, but not against aversion and anger. Similarly, the meditation on loving kindness is presented as the antidote against aversion and anger and hatred, but that type of meditation antidote will only work against emotions belonging to that class, but not against attachment. And in fact, if you examine carefully, it is also conceivable that, for example, while countering one's, you know, lust and attachment, when one meditates upon impurity of the human body, there is at least in principle the possibility that this kind of meditation can in fact lead to a form of aversion to body. So further, similarly, loving kindness meditation focused upon a specific individual, although may be helpful in dealing with aversion and anger and hatred, but, you know, there is also the possibility that as a result of that kind of cultivation, it can enhance one's attachment. In contrast, the antidote that is recommended against ignorance and delusion, which is the wisdom of emptiness, this antidote is applicable to all afflictions, whereas the other antidotes are effective only with respect to specific afflictions. So Chandrakirti makes this point. And for example, even from our own personal point of view, sort of experience point of view, if we try to understand the nature of the afflictions when they arise, we can at least make some estimation as to how delusion or grasping at true existence serves as the basis for their arising. For example, when we have strong emotion towards an object, say an attachment or anger, underlying that emotion or emotional reaction is an assumption of some kind of solid reality to which we are reacting to, which presupposes a notion of an independent or truly existing object. So here, therefore, the moment we are able to bring in the wisdom element and reveal the constructed nature of that object that we are reacting to, then the grip of our grasping tends to get released, lessen. So, for example, Nagarjuna in his 15th chapter on fundamental wisdom of the middle way, when defining the notion of svabhava, in intrinsic nature, he says intrinsic nature presupposes something that is unconstructed and something that is independent. So, and the implication here is that when we grasp, when we emotionally react to something, we tend to presuppose that object that we are reacting to be independent and unconstructed, something that is solid and concrete. And therefore, the moment we are able to lessen that grasping at the solidity and dissolve, dismantle that concreteness, then it has the effect of loosening that that grip. So the wisdom which is presented as the antidote against delusion is the wisdom realizing dependent origination in terms of emptiness. And so here, in fact, an old scientist that I met a couple of years ago in our discussion, he told me that, and he's a psychoanalyst, and he told me that when an individual experiences a strong anger towards another person, at that moment, he or she projects a court, especially when he experiences hatred, he or she perceives a quality of undesirableness in the object, and within that perception, 90% of the quality that we attribute to that object is a mental projection. So this is, of course, he's not talking from the Buddhist understanding, he's talking as a scientist, and this view fits really well with the basic Buddhist understanding of the arising of the afflictions, where underlying attachment and aversion are what is called false attention, false attentional processes, and which then gives rise to the emotional reactions. So the Buddhist understanding fits really well with the modern scientific understanding of these emotions as well.